Well, praise God. Are you ready for the Word of God this morning? So much has been talked about this morning about being obedient to the Word. And Josh got up and he started talking about being obedient to the Word. And it's so important for us because that opens the door that I was talking about to God being able to bless us, is to be obedient to His Word. We know that the Bible says that the Word of God is powerful and alive, sharper than any two-edged sword, and is able to divide soul and spirit and joint and marrow, and is a discerner of the thoughts and the intents of man's heart. It says so in Hebrews chapter 4. And in John 15, Jesus says, "If you abide in me and my words abide in you," does God's word abide in you? See, it's not enough to be a reader of the word. We certainly need to be a reader of the word, but it's not enough to be a reader of the word. God reminded me of a proverb this morning as I was in the worship. And in Proverbs chapter 4, it says, "My son, give attention to my words." That word attention is not just like, oh yeah, this is the word. No, give attention to what God is saying. That means you actually have to do what God is saying to get that door open, to get the blessing in. Amen. And James says, don't just be a hearer of the word, but be a doer of the word. We have to do the word of God. We have to walk in the word of God. We have to be true to the word of God. And when we start to live the word of God and do the things that Jesus says to us, and do the things, that's it. See, that proverb says, "My son." See, this is my son. Who says my son? The Father, right? No one else can say my son except for the Father. "My son, give attention to my word. Incline your ears to my sayings. Do not let them depart from your eyes. Keep them in the midst of your heart, for they are life to those who find them and health to all their flesh." See, the reason that we don't see the abundance that Jesus died for in our life is because we're not true to the Word of God. We don't do the Word of God. We do some of the Word of God. See, we're not so much Word people, we're favorite Word people. Because I've got my favorite scriptures, and you've got them too, right? I've got my favorite scriptures that I love to quote, and they're the ones I do. But the scriptures I find hard to do, you don't often hear me talk about them. You're the same? Because not all the Word of God is easy to do, right? But when we learn to do it at the expense of our own self, we will start to see that the blessing of God starts to flow in our life. And the more we push into the Word of God, the more we do the Word of God, the more we obey the Word of God, the more blessing. But we reach a point, church, that we come to and we're really comfortable on where we're at with the Word of God, and we don't push on. And I want to encourage you to push on today. Josh sent me a message the other day and he said, "Dad, do you have any pictures or anything to put up on the screen?" I said, "I don't even have a title to my message. I don't have a title." I said, it's in here and I've got to get it out of here. But so you can put whatever title you want on this message this morning. Whatever speaks to you in this message this morning, you can title it however you want. I'll probably title it afterwards. Okay? I often put titles on my message afterwards. Because somewhere in the middle I'll say something and I think, that's a good title. So I don't really have a title to my message. We're going to the Old Testament today. And I want to tell you a story, really. I'm going to preach, but I want to preach out of a story in the Old Testament. And it's about walking in obedience to the Word of God to receive the fullness of His blessing. The fullness of His blessing. See, the fullness of His blessing is eternal life, amen? When we're fully with Him, and when we see Him, we shall be like Him. When this old mortal body puts on immortality, and this old sinful body is no longer sinful, but I get this new perfect body, and Whoa, glory to God. But as a battle from here till then, whilst I live in this body, this mortal body. And so I want, as I'm obedient to the Word of God, more and more and more, and you'll only be obedient to the Word of God as you learn the Word of God and as you know the Word of God. If you don't know what the Word of God says, you'll not know how to walk. You'll not know what to do. You won't know what to be true to and what's your ideas and what's God's ideas. So we go into the first book of Samuel this morning. You can find it in your Bible. It's an easy book to find. You start at Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy, Joshua, Judges, Ruth. Keep going. Samuel, 1 Samuel. That's why you have to learn them, Steve. Steve said to me the other day, I've got all the books of the Bible. I'm trying to learn the books of the Bible. He said, because when you say a scripture, by the time I get to the book, you've moved on about three more. And I apologize for that. But sometimes I only have a short period of time to preach on a Sunday morning. And I've got like a week, or especially if I haven't preached for a couple of weeks. Look out. I've got a week or two. If I got a day's worth of scripture in me, I could preach all day. But if I haven't preached for a couple of weeks, Josh said, you always know when you haven't preached, Dad, you don't shut up. Like you get up there during the worship, you get up there during the offering, you start preaching. Because I'm like Jeremiah. You can call me Jeremiah if you want. Because I've got the Word of God shut up in my bones. And it's like a fire. And it wants to come out. Amen. And once I get up here, look out. Because if you've got a few hours, I can preach. Have you found 1 Samuel? We're going to chapter 9, Steve. You got 1 Samuel, Steve? You there? Good man. Me and Steve are good friends. Hungry for the Word of God. Are you hungry for the Word of God?
Yes.
Hungry for you. You're going to listen to a story today. I'm going to tell you a story. I'm going to read a few verses of Scripture, but I need you to go home and read 1 Samuel chapter 9 and 10. And it's a story of a son who gets instruction from his father. Ladies, you're a son of God. You okay with that? You okay with being a son? It's okay, I have to be the bride of Christ. So we're sons of God. Glory to God. There was a man. Chapter 9, verse 1 of 1 Samuel. There was a man of Benjamin whose name was Kish, the son of Abiel and the son of a few other people. Verse 2. And he had a choice and handsome son whose name was Saul. There was not a more handsome person than he among the children of Israel. From his shoulders up, he was taller than any of the people. Verse 3, now the donkeys of Kish, Saul's father, were lost. And Kish said to his son Saul, please take one of the servants with you. Arise and go and look for the donkeys. So he passed through the mountains of Ephraim and through the land of Shalisha, but they did not find them. Then they passed through the land of Shalim, and they were not there. Then he passed through the land of the Benjamites, but they did not find them. When they had come to the land of Suph, Saul said to his servant who was with him, come, let us return, lest my father cease caring about these donkeys and become worried about us. And he said to him, look now, there is in this city a man of God, and he's an honorable man. All that he says surely comes to pass. So let us go there. Perhaps he can show us the way that we should go. I'm going to stop reading there. You can carry on reading for your homework this afternoon. Okay, the rest of chapter 9 and chapter 10. And we see the story here of a son who has a father who is very wealthy. Verse 1 says that there was a man of Benjamin whose name was Kish, a Benjamite, a mighty man of power. That word power in there, if you have a look in your original text, means mighty man of wealth. He was very wealthy. the father had lots, very wealthy man. And Saul, who we know later on became the king and the first king of Israel, he was Kish's son. So we're telling a story this morning of a son whose father is very wealthy. You have a father in heaven this morning. You born again this morning? You have a father in heaven who is wealthy beyond means. He has everything. He owns everything. The world is his and the fullness of it. Amen? There is nothing that he won't share with you, that he won't give you when you need it. For he says that he will meet all your needs according to his riches in glory. His riches in glory. How rich is he? He's very wealthy. See, if he gives to me, he doesn't have less so that he can't give to you. Because there's an endless supply. An endless supply. Now, we find this young man, the son, Saul, he's been given a command or a request or an order from his father. So we see in our life, we see that God gives us commands. He gives us requests. He gives us orders. He gives us seek attention. Pay attention to my word, the book of Proverbs said, we just read. And Saul gets this request or this order from his father. And some donkeys are missing. Go look for the donkeys. If I was the son of a very wealthy man, I wouldn't be going to look for donkeys. I'd say, what good are donkeys? Yeah, you don't see many donkeys here in Australia. Come to India with me. And donkeys are renowned to be stupid. They're beasts of burden. They're great. If you want someone to carry something for you, a donkey will do it. Okay? But they are so stupid, in India, they stand in the middle of the road. And they're too dumb to get out the way. And in our family, if you do something stupid, my grandson will say, "Granddad, you're such a donkey." I think because my daughter used to call me a donkey, but she doesn't now. But my grandson does. And they go, "You donkey." So donkeys are good for what they're doing, but he's a rich man, and some donkeys have gone missing, and the son has got to go look for them. I would have said, send a servant. It's not my job to go looking for donkeys. Dad, I'm your son. The story's got nothing to do with donkeys. The story's got everything to do with being obedient to the word of God, to the word of the Father. See, God's going to ask you to do things that's not necessarily in the plan of where he wants to take you. He's just trying to teach you to be obedient. Do you know that? Some of my young people here, I asked them to do things because I'm testing them to see whether they're going to be obedient. They may want to join the music team. But if they won't be obedient to the smallest thing, they're not getting on the stage. Amen? One young girl here one morning, I was practicing doing music, and she was sitting down there, and I knew she wanted to be in the music team. She was only about 14 at the time. And I said to her, "Can you go make me a cup of tea?" I didn't want a cup of tea, but God said, "Tell her to go make you a cup of tea. I want to show you what's in her heart." And she went, "I'm making you a cup of tea. I can't make tea." And I thought, see, God is just showing us that if you can't obey the one you can see, how will you ever obey the one you can't see? And that weren't a big task, was it, to make a cup of tea? Can everyone make a cup of tea? See, I didn't ask for a nice cup of tea. I just asked for a cup of tea. It's not that hard, is it? But she wouldn't do it. She never joined the music team. But there was another young girl who was in my music team now who did go and make me a cup of tea. Do you understand? See, it's nothing to do with the request of the task. It's about obedience to the request. And so he obeys his father, and he takes a servant with him to keep him company, and off they go to look for these dumb donkeys. And then the story gets really exciting, because if you read the Word of God, if you study the Word of God, it starts to get more exciting than just reading the Word of God. Because you need to find out what places mean, the names mean in the Bible. I love to see people's journeys and find out where they go and what the places mean. And we pick it up in verse 4. So he passed through the mountains of Ephraim. Do you know this son lived in his father's house? Do you live in your father's house? Your father? Yeah. You're in your father's house. You're a son of your father. You are blessed. Amen. You are blessed just living in the house. King David said in the great Psalm 23, that I may dwell in your house forever. And you don't even have to pray that. You have that. You are blessed if you are born again. If you are a child of God, you are more than blessed. Just living in your father's house. But I tell you what, there's more blessing when you step out in obedience to his word. You're blessed already. Amen? You're blessed already. But when you start to step out in obedience to his word, the first place he comes to is a place called Ephraim. Ephraim, do you know what the word means? It was named after Joseph's son, Ephraim, who was the second born. Manasseh was his firstborn. Ephraim was his second born. The word Ephraim means double blessing. The first thing you will hit when you step out obeying the word of God is double blessing. You're already blessed just by being saved in your father's house. When you follow the word of God and you obey the word of God, you hit this point of double blessing. Most people never hit this point of double blessing. They're just blessed being a Christian. And they just enjoy being a Christian. But when you start to step out, when God gives you a command or an order or a request, and you say, I'll do it, Lord, I'll do it, I'll go, Lord. And when he says, who will go for me? And you say, like Isaiah, here I am, send me. And you go, you hit a place of double blessing. How do I know that means double blessing? Ephraim was the second born of Joseph. Manasseh was his firstborn. And when Joseph gets together with Jacob again down in Egypt, remember when Jacob goes to Egypt and he meets his son Joseph again? And he says, I think it's in chapter 48 in Genesis, he says, who are these boys? And Joseph said, they're my boys, Dad. These are your grandsons. He had two grandsons by Joseph. And he says, like Blake and Kai. And like Manasseh would be like Blake, and Kai would be like Ephraim. Ephraim was the second born. And Jacob said, bring them to me. I want to bless them. And see, under the Jewish law, in the children of Israel, the firstborn, if there's five kids in the family, and when the inheritance is divided up, they all get one portion, but the firstborn gets a double portion. The firstborn gets a double, Blake gets a double portion. Okay? Do you understand this? The firstborn gets a double portion, the rest of them get the rest one portion. So when Joseph brought his children to Jacob, to his father Jacob, and he wanted to bless the grandchildren, see, Joseph knows the rules of the family. So he brings Manasseh and he puts him by Jacob's right hand. Doesn't the Bible says, at your right hand are what? Pleasures forevermore. Amen. The right hand is the hand of authority, the hand of power, the hand of blessing. That's why we shake by the right hand. Even left-handed people shake right-handed. Did you know that? Come on. I never seen a man come up to me yet and put his left hand out, unless his right arm is missing. I've had that. So he brings Manasseh to his right hand and he brings Ephraim to his left hand. And Jacob goes like this. And he blesses the secondborn with the firstborn's blessing. And Joseph said, oh, Dad, you got it wrong. Don't you know, old man, your mind is going. Don't you know you're supposed to bless Manasseh with your right hand? And Jacob said, nothing wrong with my mind, boy. I know what I'm doing. The second born gets the larger share of blessing. Who's more blessed, your flesh or your born-again spirit? Your firstborn, Jesus said to Nicodemus in John 3, that which is born of flesh is flesh. That which is born of the spirit is spirit. It's your born again man who is blessed with double blessing. So Ephraim got the double blessing. And Ephraim means when you step out in the Word of God, they come to Ephraim first. And they see, when you're obedient to the Word of God, you receive double blessing. You receive double blessing. So I don't need a Bible, it's in here. And when they get to Ephraim and the donkeys are not there. So if I would have been the son and I'd have been doubly blessed by my father, not just blessed by being in my father's house, but doubly blessed by being obedient to his word, I'd have said to the servant, stupid donkeys are gone, let's go home. Saul never said that. He said, let's go on. And they moved on. I don't know how far, I'll have to get the map. They went on from Ephraim and next place they came to was a place called Shalisha. And so he's not just being obedient to where he wants to be obedient, he's being obedient to the fullness of the word. Go search for my donkeys. Who wants to call the message searching for donkeys? It's nothing to do with the donkeys. He gets to Shalisha. Shalisha means threefold blessing. Three. See, the further you go in the fullness of God's word, the more blessed you get. The more blessed you get. So they get to Shalisha, and it's a blessing again. It's an extra level of blessing. There's a wonderful story, I think it's in 2 Kings chapter 4, of a man from Shalisha who brings some bread, and he feeds the whole army with some bread. I tell you, the blessings of Shalisha go a long way. They're greater than a double blessing. It means a threefold. The word Shalisha. Okay? But they get there, no dumb donkeys. So, but this guy lived in his father's house where there was great blessing, but he wanted to fulfill his dad's request. He loved his dad. And whatever his dad said, that's what he wanted to do. So they never found them in Shalisha, although their continuing blessing is continuing upon their life. So they go on. And they come to the next place called Shalim. So if there's blessing in the father's house, and there's double blessing as you step out in the word of God at Ephraim, and there's treble blessing as you go on in the place of Shalisha, and guess what's happening in Shalim? What does the word Shalim mean? I was excited. I was looking through my concordance. I couldn't wait to see how much blessing we was going to get now in Shalim. And I looked up the word Shalim in my Hebrew Bible, and it means foxes. And I go, you've just wrecked my message, God. I was going to tell the people how much blessing they were going to get as they continue to move in the Word of God. And God says, yeah, and when you're blessed, watch out for the little foxes. Because the second chapter of the Song of Solomon says it's the little foxes that spoil the vine. Amen. See, there's a place to be blessed, and there's a place of receiving greater blessing as you operate in the Word of God. And then when you think that you can't receive any more blessing and you get really comfortable in this blessing, the enemy comes in like a flood. And you don't even see you're being set up. The enemy's just waiting for you to be so full of yourself. I'm blessed. Look at this. God's got himself a servant in the earth. Whoa, he's blessed me beyond measure. He's more than double blessed me. He's more than treble blessed me. Oh, nothing can happen to me now. How many men of God have said that? And it's the little foxes that come in and spoil the vine. Watch out for the little foxes. He never found the donkeys in Shalim. Amen. So he went on. See, when the little foxes come and when things start to go wrong in your life and then you don't have to run back to Shalisha or to the other place and then to back to the father's house. No, you stand strong in the face of the enemy and you don't fall for that junk. You say, Yes, I'm blessed, but I know from whence my blessing comes. It comes from God. And like Josh was saying to Blake, take you back to God. It all comes from God. And then you can get excited about the things of God. So he moves on from his place of Shalem. And he goes through the land of Benjamin and he comes to a next place called Suf. Suf. What a great name. And I'm like, okay, so if there's little foxes at Shalem, what's waiting for him in Suf? And the Bible says the word Suf means honeycomb. Honeycomb. See, once you overcome those little foxes, once you say no to sin that so easily besets us, we step from blessing into a land of the honeycomb. And I think it's in the book of Deuteronomy, it talks about sucking honey from the rock. We used to sing songs like this back years ago. Like honey in the rock, sweet honey in the rock, for he tastes like honey in the rock. Oh, taste and see that the Lord is good, for he tastes like honey in the rock. Anyone remember that song? Oh, look at all the old hands going up. Praise God. Hallelujah. Okay, let me get back here so I can just cut that piece out. That's right, then I won't look like I jumped across the stage. Thank God for the honey in the rock, Christ Jesus. Amen. See, the further you go in God, in the obedience to God's word, the further you go in keeping God's word, the more blessing, the more blessing, the more blessing. And we don't do it just to get the blessing. That's a byproduct. We're already blessed in the Father's hands. But when we can overcome the little foxes that so easily spoil the vine. Amen. Because they didn't, the little foxes said, it talks about being sweet fruit, sweet grapes on the vine. That's what the little foxes spoil, the fruit. The fruit. He can't spoil the vine. He tried to do that. Jesus said, I am the vine, you are the branches. You bear the fruit. He comes to try to spoil, but we're not going to let it happen, are we? We're going to push through and stay obedient to God's word. And we're going to receive the fullness. You know, the story goes on, and he's in Suf, that then Saul says, he thinks about his dad. They've come a long way. They've been traveling for some time. They've gone from their father's house through Ephraim and Shalisha and Salim to Zuf. And he said, my dad's going to be worried about me now. You know, I reckon we should head back now. And the servant says, see, in this story, you represent the Son. God represents the Father. And I say this with all reverence, the Holy Spirit represents the servant. I say that with reverence? Because I don't want to treat him like a servant, but that's what he is. The Bible says he's called the paraclete. He's the helper, the one who comes alongside you to lead you into all truth. He's the one who said, well, didn't Jesus say he was a servant? So if Jesus called himself a servant, then surely the Holy Spirit, the work he's done, or the work he does with you and for you, leading you into all truth, he's serving you. And Saul says, let's return back. And the servant says, I know something you don't know. The Holy Spirit always knows the answer. He always knows something you don't know. He says, in this, see, how did a servant know what a son didn't know? That there was a man of God in Suf that could show them the way. He said, there's a man of God here. Let's go down and ask him. He can tell us what we need to know. And Saul says, how can we go down? we don't have anything to bring to the man of God. We don't have anything to bring. See, when you went to see a man of God, and a prophet in those days, you had to take an offering. You had to take a gift. And so the servant said, it's okay, I've got some silver. The son of the wealthy man had nothing, and the servant's got the silver. I'm still trying to work that one out. I haven't got an answer for that yet. But the servant knows what's coming up ahead, amen? The Holy Spirit knows what you'll need up ahead. And He's got everything you need. The first epistle of John says, and you have an anointing from the Holy One, and you know all things because of the anointing that abides within you, the Holy Spirit. You know all things when you need to know it. You're not a know-all. Okay? But you know all things. When you need to know it, the Holy Spirit will reveal it to you. And he said, there's a man of God in the town. We can go to him. We've got some offering. We're going to give it to him. They went down to see Samuel, the man of God. And Samuel knew they were coming because he was such a great man of God. He's a prophet. God speaking to him. And the story takes a few twists and turns, but they go down and Samuel said, come up for lunch and we'll eat together later on, blah, blah, blah. Story goes on. And the whole story about being obedient to God was to set Saul up for something. See, when God is asking you to be obedient to His Word, He's setting you up for something. Not just for a blessing in the Father's house, or double blessing as you go searching, or treble blessing, or even overcoming foxes, but He's wanting to do something in your life which is far beyond your understanding. I truly believe this, church, that the fullness of what we get is a crown of life. Amen? Paul said, and I will receive the crown of life. And the letters to the churches, and there's a crown of life waiting for you. And at the end of Saul's journey, there was a crown waiting for him. Because he went to see Samuel, and Samuel anointed him king of Israel. How else would he have been anointed king of Israel? How else would God get Saul from his father's house over to Zuph, where Samuel was ready to anoint him king, if he weren't going to be obedient to the word of his father and follow the course that his father had sent him on? And some people never receive the blessing that God has got for you because you turn back too soon. You don't push through with the word of God. Oh, well, I've been obedient this far and this is enough. You know, like, it doesn't matter if I'm not obedient in this bit. I've been obedient in this. Surely that's enough, God. Surely you don't mind if I just go this way. And God says, you can go that way if you want to go that way, but there's no crown down there. You can go that way, but I need you to go to Zuph. Saul, come on, I need you to get to Zuph. I've got somebody waiting for you to crown you. I've got someone waiting to anoint you. See, there's people even in this auditorium right now. Your ministry should have been somewhere here, and you're still here. And you're still thinking, oh, well, this ministry's okay down here. I'm enjoying this ministry down here. But you should be in this ministry over here. Because when you got to Shalim and the little foxes came in and they started to wreck your life and you started to say, this is not fair. Why is this happening to me? This is not good. I'm going to leave that church and I'm going to do this and I'm not going to read my Bible anymore. And God, if you do this to me, I'm not going to pray. And then see where you get. As if God needs you. God doesn't need you. You need Him. Amen. You need Him to see you through the Zuph, where you can be anointed for ministry, where you can be anointed for kingship. Hallelujah. So what's the title of my message? I don't know. You choose. But I'll tell you this. Don't stop. Be obedient to God's word. Keep going in God's word. If God's word tell you to do this, then do it. In Deuteronomy chapter 28, is a book of blessing. And you know the amazing thing? That He hasn't done away with blessing. And Jesus never came to remove the blessing from your life. He came to remove the curse. So you've got a book. Deuteronomy chapter 28 is that the first 14 verses are all the blessings that come to you if you're obedient to God's word. And from verse 15 on to the end of the chapter is all the curses if you're not into God's word, if you're not obedient to God's word. But thank God for Jesus that he took away the curse and he only left the blessing. See, if you're not obedient to God's word, the foxes will run over your life. And they'll come and see, they can't keep you out of heaven because it's not through obedience that you get saved. It's through the obedience of the one who went to the cross. The Bible says that he learned obedience, even the obedience of the cross. See, when you read the start of chapter 28 of Deuteronomy, it says, and it shall come to pass if you diligently obey the voice of the Lord your God to observe all the commandments which I command you today. You know that this was written to the Jews. We don't live under that dispensation of law anymore. And Jesus came and fulfilled the law on your behalf. But you've still got to be obedient to his word. He didn't take obedience away. Hallelujah. Oh God, you're going, taking me somewhere. Hallelujah, Jesus. And it goes on to say, if you're obedient to his word, all these blessings will overtake you. They won't just come on you, they'll overtake you. If something overtakes you, it's then in front of you, right? You're walking into it. You're coming into it. It's behind you, overtaking you, and in front of you, blessing. If you're obedient to God's word. But people, that it's not easy to be obedient to God's word. I started off by saying it's easy to be obedient to some of his word. Ooh, I love being obedient to some of his word. When it suits me. But to be obedient to all of his word. The more obedience, the more blessing. Now, if you're born again this morning, you are blessed beyond measure. You are so blessed you don't realize how blessed you are. But there's greater. I like watching TV when I go to my daughter's house. On Friday nights, I'm a channel flicker. And because I don't watch telly at home, it doesn't mean I don't want to watch telly. It's just that I can restrict it. And I'm such a channel flicker. There's nothing on telly, right? You've got a million and one channels and there's nothing to watch. And so I flick channels until I find men kicking a ball. And then I'll hang in there for 5 minutes. But I like shopping channels. Do you watch the shopping channels? You like when they sell stuff? They just make, I just laugh. Mate, it's so funny. They never tell you how much it is. But if you ring now, if you call in the next 10 minutes, you only have to make 740 payments. And he tells you all his stuff, and then he goes, but hold on, there's more. And like, it's the only time I laugh when I'm really on my own at the TV. And then he tells you all this as if you couldn't get enough. He says, but then we'll throw in this. And then we'll add this. And there's more. And I think, I've got to turn it over. Because he's never going to stop this guy. And God says, you're blessed. But there's more. There's more. There's more to abundance of life than just being born again. There's more to be an abundance of life than just ministry. The fullness of the abundance of life, Paul said, is that I might know him. Amen. I'd give it all up, Paul said, that I might know him. And the only way to know him is when we're obedient to his word. Amen. You know, there's a great story of Saul going from one place, next place, next place. There's a lot more I could preach out of that. But I'll leave it there this morning. Just to know this, people of God. When we're obedient to his word, when we know what his word says. See, we're not responsible for what we don't know. Did you know that? This... I went diving the other day, and you're supposed to have a briefing before you go diving. And so we was going to have this briefing, and this dive master said to me, "What don't you know?" I said, "I don't know what I don't know." And he said, "Well, I don't know what you don't know." And the conversation was going, and I just started laughing. And I said, "I don't think anybody know what they don't know." I said, "Why don't we just start from the beginning? And if there's anything that I don't know, I'll tell you when you say it that I don't know it." And it was like a comedy act. And it went on for about 2 or 3 minutes. And we're not responsible for what we don't know. But when we know it, we're responsible for it. Amen. That's why we need to read the Bible and know what God says. I'll finish off with this scripture in Joshua. The start of Joshua. This is, if you could grasp this one scripture, it would change your whole life. It would truly change your whole life. The book of the law. This is the book of God. This is the word of God. The book of the law to us today is the Bible. The book of the law then was what we know as the Torah. Genesis, Exodus, Leviticus, Numbers, Deuteronomy. It was the law of the Lord. But we have the fullness of the word of God in our hands. If you don't have one of these, come and see me. If you don't have a Bible, come and see me. I'll give you one. I'll get you a Bible. Because you can't live as a Christian without a Bible. Amen? And it says this, "The book of the law shall not depart from your mouth." That doesn't mean you're just reading it. That means you're speaking it. You're speaking it. You're speaking the word of God. I don't know how many scriptures you think I've quoted to you since I've been preaching in the last half an hour, but a lot. A lot of scripture. "But you shall meditate on God's word day and night." Oh, come on, Pastor, I'm struggling to get a few verses in the morning before I go to work. Well, that's why you're where you are. That's the reason why your life is where it is at right now. Because you're not meditating on the Word of God. Oh, but I read the Word of God, Pastor. I read for a couple of minutes every morning when I'm driving down the freeway. It's a joke. You can have it, you can listen to it driving down the freeway, but you're not going to meditate on it. Meditate on it day and night. That you, listen to this, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. See, when you meditate on the Word of God, you learn the Word of God so that you may know the Word of God, that you can see to do the Word of God, to obey the Word of God. "For then you will make your way prosperous." You will make your way prosperous. It didn't say, "Then I will make your way prosperous." God didn't say, if you meditate on the Word of God day and night and observe to do all that is written in it, then I will make your way. No, He didn't say that. He said, "You will make your way prosperous." See, we do it for ourselves. See, this will work for anybody. "And then you will have good success." Well, have you seen my life, Pastor? Like, it ain't exactly like success story, is it? Why? Maybe it's because you're not meditating on the Word of God, because God's Word is true. Amen. If you meditate on it day and night and observe to do according to all that's written in it, then you will make your way prosperous. Then you will have good success. Amen. It all comes back to doing this. Come back to doing this. Yes. Father in heaven, I thank you today for this great church. I thank you that you are the head of your church. I thank you that you birthed your church. I thank you, Lord, that you will watch over your church. You will fill your church with the Word of God. Lord God, that you will protect your church. you will provide for your church. And this church is made up of living stones, the people of God, sons and daughters of God that make your church. I pray, Father, that this year, 2017, will be a year when we will stop doing according to ourselves and do according to your word. For your word declares that where there is no king, every man will do what is right in the sight of his own eyes. But we have a king, and his name is Jesus. And we will do according to the king, the words of the king, the words of our father. And we will be like Saul, an obedient young man that did all according to the word of his father. In Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.